website, DallasLeft.org. We're going to put up some photos and like this one tonight, so if you want to go there in a day or so, we should have that up. It'll be kind of neat. And we're also going to have two free bands, so you can follow those on the website. There will also be a place where you can get on mail list and like that. Dallas Left is an organization that has existed in Dallas before, but is coming back from a bit of a hiatus. The idea of Dallas Left is that we have a lot of different groups in Dallas which are anti-capitalists, which say the problem here fundamentally is capitalism, right? And a lot of these groups have some differences of opinion about different things about that, right? And traditionally, a lot of us on the left tend to be very sectarian, two or three here, and two or three here, and two or three here. So the idea is to try and build a platform where we can cooperate and work together. And if there are disagreements, then sometimes we might not be able to work together, but whenever possible, we would work together. And I think that that method has kind of been vindicated by what you're seeing tonight, which I think is one of the most successful events that the anti-capitalist left in Dallas has had.
Woo! Woo!
That's an approach that works because of people with somewhat different perspectives working together and finding common ground instead of emphasizing the relatively minor areas of difference that exist. So I hope you'll go to DallasLeft.org and I hope you'll follow us and I hope you'll come to our future events. I'm also, people have been asking me what organization you're with. Of course, it's Dallas Left, but I think like a lot of people here, I'm with a lot of different organizations. So the other one, I have a newspaper over there, Fight Back News. It's put out by the Freedom Road Socialist Organization. So go and get your Fight Back News before you leave. And thank you very much.
Woo! Woo! On May 4th, what was it, 1886, I probably would have been kind of concerned. Because the day before, a peaceful rally of laborers fighting for an 8-hour workday had been fired upon by police. At least two of them died. Some newspapers said six. So in their outrage, people called a rally for the next day. After a couple of hours of peaceful speech making, much like we have had here, though longer, so those speeches were a few hours long, I will spare you. But at the end of it, a few hundred cops showed up and told everyone to disperse. A bomb was thrown. The police fired on the crowd again. Incidentally, they also fired on each other. Those guns back then put off a lot of smoke and they weren't sure where to aim. They just sort of fired all over the place. And after that day, seeing an opportunity, the police rounded up all the labor organizers they could find. They got eight anarchists. They sentenced seven of them to death. They sentenced one to, I think, 15 years in jail. A couple of their sentences were commuted. Five of them were killed by the state. And their deaths, tragically, but thankfully in the end, led to a multiracial movement of women, men, laborers, immigrants, religious leaders who fought for and won the 8-hour workday, and y'all can see how that's wound up for us now. So I look around me in Dallas, and you should look around the crowd, like right now. Look around you, look to your left, look to your right. Spend a little longer on the left, but look around. You're probably going to see some faces you haven't seen before. I know I only know about half these people. And I think that's representative of Dallas activism. We have so much good work going on, and we don't have nearly enough people knowing about the work that's going on. There are organizations today that I hadn't heard of. I didn't know Rashad was doing homeless organizing until yesterday. And this is something that concerns me, because we have energy being spent and work being done, and we have resources distributed across this sprawling city that people don't know exist. So what we need to do in movement building is we need to be forming intentional relationships with other people. Okay?
Yes, yes.
Because movements are not won by a group of five friends in an apartment. reading radical literature. That's important. But if you don't leave the apartment and go to somebody else's meetings and build a relationship, coalitions are not going to exist. They don't spring up fully formed from the head of Zeus. They are a product of struggle and work. And if we want to build a world in which we control our own destinies, in which we are working together to build the world we are living in, we have to start right now. We can't wait for some future to start speaking with one another, okay?
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
And I'm not the only person who thinks this way. The FBI agrees. The FBI doesn't waste resources. Well, that's debatable. The FBI doesn't spend resources for nothing. They attempt to dismantle organizations that are accomplishing things. What kind of people does the FBI go after? You look at MLK is a classic example. MLK was not one movement. MLK was doing racial justice, but he was forming coalitions with women's groups. He was forming coalitions with labor. And when the people in power start being concerned about your organizing, that says something very good about your organizing if your intent is to take power from those who are in power. Okay? Harvey Milk in San Francisco boycotted orange juice because they were homophobic as fuck. And he accomplished this by forming coalitions with union groups who traditionally had been extremely homophobic. But they came together because they had a common enemy and a common goal to be achieved. So, where am I? And the media doesn't promote the two-party system for nothing. The schools do not gloss over radical organizing for nothing. And the master is not going to give you the tools to dismantle the master's house. The things they aren't telling you and the things they keep out of your hands and away from your eyes and your ears are the things you need to be seeking out for yourselves. And we as a community have a responsibility to each other to be teaching the histories that we haven't been taught. As a queer activist,
yay!
As a bisexual activist,
woo!
I personally, you don't see queer history in schools because they don't want us learning about ourselves. And this is true of every radical movement. So when we see these things, we have a responsibility to come together and overcome these hurdles that have been implanted in our paths, landmines, as we keep finding them. And we have a responsibility to do this because another world is possible. This world was created by, this society was created by human beings. It was built by human hands and human endeavor. It was not inevitable. None of this is inevitable. This condition we find ourselves in could change tomorrow if everyone decided it needed to be different. So we need to be building that tomorrow intentionally, constantly, fervently. And when Albert Speier in the trial room back in Chicago in 1886, in the courtroom that would eventually kill him as it happened, he said, if you think that hanging me will stamp out the labor movement, hang me. Here you trod upon a spark, but there and they're behind you and they're in front of you and everywhere flames spring up. It is a subterranean fire. You cannot put it out.
Woo!
So we are called to be sparks. Make a flame, and sparks make brush fires, and sparks keep burning down California. And we are called as we to be tidal wave. We are called to be bonfire. We are called to be earthquake. We are called to be the force that brings us out of this world into the one that is ahead of us. But we have to walk there, and we cannot get there without you. Thank you very much for coming out.
Woo!
Have a good day.